That is the grade of recanalization that we are able to achieve in good number of patients. This is one of the examples, a 74-year-old male who had a coronary stent placement a few years ago. He was on Plavix. He was found down at about 8:30 a.m. and he came to the hospital with a MCA syndrome with a stroke scale of about 25. The initial CT scan, as you can see here, showed a hypertensive MCA sign. This was the initial picture. The M1 was occluded. There was no flow beyond it. The clot was sitting here. We put the stent retriever. You can see here, the stent is here. We put the stent retriever and we pull it out. We took out the clot, re-establishing flow into the MCA on the right side. And the patient recovered clinically very well. He had a small area of infarct, but he made an excellent clinical recovery. And then now we have this kind of a catheter. These catheters, we work from the groin to the brain. Right? These catheters have to be made in such a way that it is atraumatic to the patient and it has to get to those vessels pretty quickly. Because as people age, the blood vessels sag down and there is so much of tortuosity in the vessel, it is not easy to get to the brain with inadequate devices. This catheter is made in such a way that it has about 25 transition zones. It's extremely supple at the tip and it is more robust at the proximal end. So we are able to take this catheter in about 5-10 minutes into the intracranial circulation and we are able to achieve a direct aspiration. This catheter is a large bore catheter. We put it right on the clot and we pull it and we apply the suction for about 3-4 minutes and then we pull it out. This is direct aspiration. What this catheter introduction in 2014 has done is that it has made this procedure really faster. As you can see here, this was one of the greatest achievements at that time. Today we are able to do the fastest thrombectomy I've done from the groin puncture to removing the clot is about 13 minutes. But at that time, it was about 25 minutes, which was great. And from then on, we have been achieving much faster recanalization. Because we know that time is brain. This is one of the cases, as you can see here, so much of tortuosity. You can see the catheter going around, going around, going around. And then we are able to get to the clot here and pull the clot out. So these are a few examples of MC occlusions with the clot. These are various types of clots that was removed. We had a positive response. In the initial phase, when we started doing these procedures, there was not so much enthusiasm because people never really thought that it could work. How is it going to work? Because every patient we open up does not really become better. And about 60% of them got better. We know that we are really helping the patients, but we need studies, we need proof to prove that this kind of treatment works. In 2015 and 16, there were about a plethora of trials which became positive for this therapy. The one important trial is called Mr. Clean. This was every patient who had an acute stroke, a large vessel stroke in the country of Netherlands were enrolled into this trial and they terminated the trial 3-4 stating that this therapy is extremely useful. Since then, most of these trials were stopped in between because they could not randomize anymore. They have enough evidence to prove that this therapy works. And today we know that a good number of patients, as you can see here in the control group, falling into the MRS, we are getting, with the intervention arm, we are getting good number of patients in the lower modified Rankine scale. That is what we achieve. We should understand very clearly when we are referring a patient for stroke, it's that when we do this therapy, not that every patient, it's not an on-off switch, not that every patient gets really all right, walks back the next day. A good number of patients will recover to a good functional level in about 3 months. That is what we are aiming. That is what the trial has showed. And that is what in reality we should be expecting. So, and today what is it about 24 hours is that there were two other trials called Dawn trial and Diffuse trial which had shown enough evidence that good number of patients who were treated beyond the therapeutic window after about 8 hours up to 24 hours have had good results. That is, they have fallen into a better MRS scale compared to the control arm. And this is the Diffuse 3 trial. And to select these patients beyond 6 hours up to 24 hours, what do we use? We use special imaging. That is, we use either a CT perfusion or MR perfusion. These perfusion images tell us what is the actual core of tissue that is already dead or infarcted and what is the penumbral zone that is available. If we feel the penumbral zone is really larger than the core of the infarct, then we offer treatment to those patients. We don't offer to everybody beyond 6 hours. We select the patients who can really benefit. If we offer to everybody, the risk of hemorrhage, the risk of reperfusion damage will be much higher. So we select these patients using these imagings. So this is the MR. The MR protocol, we have devised a protocol which runs for about 20 minutes. We could get all these images done and which will give us a clear idea of what which patients can benefit. And this sequence of stroke imaging in MR is not time consuming. It does not run for about 45 minutes. In about 20 minutes, we'll be able to get the report. So this, okay. Today, the bumper sticker message is that you can treat stroke up to 24 hours, not 6 hours. This is one of the patients, a 63-year-old male, last known well about 4 p.m. Usually when stroke hits during the day, in their office hours, during the working time, they get to the hospital much faster. Usually it's a wake-up stroke, that is, who sleep through with the stroke at night, they don't get to the hospital on time. This patient had a stroke at about 4 p.m., reached the hospital in about 2.5 hours. His symptoms were weird, like he had lethargy, disconjugate gaze, mild quadriparesis, NH stroke scale was 14. And this is a confusing picture because they don't have like one side arm and leg weakness. And this is the picture you get in posterior circulation strokes, in vertebrobacillar strokes, this kind of picture. They'll have giddiness for about 5-10 minutes and then they'll become increasingly lethargic and uptilted. So this was the CT scan, which was normal. A CT angiogram showed that there is a mid-basilar occlusion. This was the angiogram. As you can see here, there is a mid-basilar occlusion. This is the video actually. This catheter just flows through and we are able to get the catheter up. This is the clot that was removed. And this is actually the video of the patient. Like this particular patient like made an excellent recovery. He was intubated in the emergency room and on day 2, he was extubated, and in about a week's time he was discharged. In 2 weeks the patient was back in the office walking normally, doing everything possible. So together we can make a difference in these patients who would be left disabled if we don't offer them these kind of treatment. They will be disabled for the rest of their life, being burdened to themselves and to the family and to the society. So at Apollo, what we have designed is that, like, we have designed a protocol or a pathway for these stroke patients. When we hear that a stroke patient is coming, usually a good number of times the primary physicians call us and tell us that a patient is coming there, and before the patient comes we alert the team in such a way that the secretary, the nurse, the registrar in the emergency room, the consultant of the emergency room, they have their set of things to do. They get ready to receive the patient, and in the first phase, that is the pre-arrival triage phase, they get the information as much as possible, trying to get the phone number of the relatives, trying to get understand the pre-morbid condition of the patient and get more information about the patient so they can be mentally prepared. And in the phase 2, that is the time when the patient is already there in the hospital, secretary, for example, she gets enrolling the patient, getting the tag, getting the labels and everything ready. The nurse works on getting the blood drawn, identifying the patient, checking the basic parameters like blood pressure and other things. The registrar has his role, getting the IV access, drawing the blood, and the consultant oversees it. And the neurology team is instructed, and the neurology team comes, the neurology registrar performs the stroke scale of the patient. For example, for head injury, we measure the GCS, Glasgow Coma Scale. For stroke, we measure what is called an NIS stroke scale, which is a free app which is available in both Android and iPhones, so you can download that. It's much easier to follow. It takes about 5 to 8 minutes to do the NIS stroke scale, but it gives us exact information about what is the clinical condition of the patient. So they do the NIS stroke scale, and the patient goes to the CT, and once the imaging is done, the registrar is there looking at the CT. If it is not a hemorrhage, the patient, if he is within the 4.5 hours window, the pharmacist is alerted to give the TPA. The TPA is usually started in the CT room itself. And after the CT is done, we are contacted as a neurointerventionalist. We usually look at the images because today, thanks to the technology, we are able to see the images on our phone or on the laptop, wherever possible. Immediately we are able to see it once it is uploaded, and we make a decision right away. In 20 minutes, the patient can go to the cath lab. The patient does not improve with the intravenous thrombolytic. So that is how we work, and this is the target time, and good number of patients we are able to achieve this kind of a target time. And one thing we moving forward is that since most of these specialists, that is neurologists who are treating strokes, are concentrated in the city and they are not widely spread, and all the smaller nursing homes which do not have access to the neurologist, they call, there will be an on-call neurologist, he will be coming once a day. practically when they call today, he'll be coming maybe in the evening or maybe the next day morning, he'll be coming to see the patients. So one thing we're trying to develop is the telestroke units. Today, with the availability of the phones, with the internet network and Wi-Fi available everywhere, we're able to follow these patients and assess these patients. We're trying to have one person always ready to receive these calls, able to assess the patient at the other end and give instruction as to what needs to be done to the patient, either to give thrombolytic, and if he is eligible for further treatment, the patient can be shifted for further care. So this will really make a big change in treating strokes. So in conclusion, time is brain. That's what we need to understand. And stroke is treatable up to 24 hours from the time of onset. And stroke system of care is absolutely essential to offer this kind of a therapy. And an equipped infrastructure is essential, because if we don't have an in-house CT scan, MRI, we'll not be able to offer this kind of therapy. And we also need a cath lab. And up to 4.5 hours, IVTP is given. And up to 24 hours, mechanical thrombectomy is offered. So this is the treatment protocol which has evolved over the last 20 years. Thank you.
Sir, the brain cell is supposed to live only for 5 minutes in ischemia.
Absolutely.
If you are going to treat after 24 hours,
exactly.
How do you explain that?
Yeah, exactly. That is what I said. A good number of patients, see, it is like one little analogy I say to people when I talk to the common man. Usually we say that when a power supply is cut off and the grid fails, we have little kerosene at home, we have little generators, we have little things to light us ourselves for the few hours, beyond which our resources fail, right? Likewise, the collaterals, that is the from the ACA to MCA, as I showed you in one of the angiograms, from the ACA to MCA, from the PCA to MCA, these collaterals tend to supply. And reflexly, our body has a mechanism. In all stroke patients, if you see, their blood pressure will be higher in ischemic strokes. It's a reflex mechanism to improvise and improve these collaterals to supply blood to the region where it is lacking. So that protects the brain for quite some time. So for up to 6 hours, good number of patients will have this kind of collaterals. And beyond 6 hours, it really goes down, and we take special imaging to understand which patients are sustaining their brain before we can offer help.
Do you think there is stunning of the cells?
Yes, sir. There will
can
be
come back.
Yes, there will be stunning of cells. This penumbral zone tissue, the core infarct will not have stunning. They are dead tissues. The penumbral zone will have stunning. Even after we reperfuse, we don't see the response right away. There are patients whom we do thrombectomy right on the table, they'll be lifting their hand. But there are good number of patients who will take about 24-48 hours before their function recovers. And we usually assess their function on day one, the day after the procedure, on day 7, on the day of discharge, and then on day 90. These are the landmark days where we assess the improvement of the patient.
So, usual approach is only femoral, sir. Why not if we subject somewhere near where our stem cell reach the brain?
Yeah, the femoral approach is more safer and more easier in acute situation. There are situations where we are not able to gain access because the arch is extremely difficult. We try for about 20 minutes, 30 minutes. We are not able to achieve beyond the arch. We have done a direct carotid puncture. Yes, in the past, direct carotid puncture was the procedure for angiograms, but today femoral is much safer and we have better devices to access easily because the carotid puncture has a lot of complication issues. Achieving hemostasis after the procedure.
Subclavians are not available.
Subclavian, generally we don't access. The radial can be accessed in certain situations. But the radial, to go into the cranial circulation, it's very difficult. For a cardiac catheterization, to come from above, hook the vessels, it's easy. To go back into the brain, practically it's not feasible.
Can brain cells regenerate?
Yes, sir. Unfortunately, so far no research has proved that the brain cells regenerate. What happens is that if a region is dead, the surrounding brain tissue, with repeated therapy, with speech therapy, with rehabilitation, what happens is neuronal plasticity happens. New junctions do happen, and the surrounding cells take over the function. They learn the function new, like a child learning a new function. These adults, we tell them, you have to learn it like a child. And with speech, proper speech therapy, the new synaptic junctions develop, and the surrounding tissue undergo what is called neuronal plasticity. but no regeneration happens. And stem cell therapy is of no use, and so far there is no proven literature that stem cell therapy helps.
So whenever after regeneration, they come to normal state.
The penumbral region is the region which has not died, which has had ischemic insult, and they are in a state where there is a dysfunction. There is increased cellular swelling. Because of increased sodium, there is cellular swelling, and it takes some time to for it to settle down and start functioning again.
But it does not reach the normal state.
It does not reach what the
person. No, normalcy of.
It does, it does. If it is a true penumbral tissue, what we see in ADC map, in the MRI, what we see is DWI changes and ADC changes we see, and they usually recover very well, and their function resumes. And that is what we are capitalizing on.
So sometimes in a large implant you have hemorrhagic transformation. So what is your impression about normalizing this patient or doing reperfusion? Because the reperfusion, we can always produce an edema and increase in ECM.
Yes.
In answering your question, subclavian can never be a side of function because it is non-compulsive. Femoral and radial we can compulse. We use a lot of antiplatelets, anticoagulants. You puncture the subclavian artery, it cannot be compressed for arresting it.
That's a good point. We have never done a subclavian. And to answer your question, what was your question just now? I got
over. When a patient comes with a large injury.
Yeah, the reperfusion injury, yes. See, what happens is, reperfusion injury does happen. It's not that every patient goes home without a complication. If the tissue is already infarcted, reperfusing or like trying to establish flow into the infarcted tissue, reperfusion hemorrhages do happen. And the symptomatic reperfusion hemorrhage happens in about 6 to 8% of the patients that we do procedures on. And that should not be an impediment for you to help the patients whom you think can really potentially benefit and we can help. Because even with reperfusion, what happens is that a patient may need a little decompression. Even otherwise, even the stroke per se, if it's a large stroke, the patient will need decompression to survive. The reperfusion hemorrhages, again, you're going to do just the decompression, you're not going to do anything. Thinking that as a side effect and withholding this therapy to those patients, it doesn't help anybody. The tissue is already dead, it's not going to recover. You're trying to recover the tissue which is in the penumbral zone, which is surrounding that core, and which we can potentially reperfuse and get it restarted.
We were talking only for the large muscle stroke.
Yes.
The small muscle stroke or reticular segmental calculation where the granular capsular disease, do we give a thrombectomy?
Yes, sir, thrombolysis. Up to 4.5 hours, they are treated with thrombolysis, but no thrombectomy is offered to those patients.
You have any experience of this ectogenic stroke case and reason for that? Any idea of device closure with PFO?
Device closure with PFO causing. Yes, sir, we have seen. I mean, certainly, I mean, all the patients with stroke, especially stroke in young, this is one of the causes of stroke in young. We always, always assess these patients before they leave the hospital for the cause of the stroke. And the evaluation includes cardiac electrical abnormality, structural abnormality, and then the carotid abnormality, and then the blood abnormalities and blood vessel abnormalities. So all of these are taken into account, and we have a plethora of tests that the patient undergoes before the patient is let out of the hospital.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.